Today I'm showing you how to paint a dramatic and vintage-inspired dark floral watercolor. Hi guys, what's up? My name is Shada. Welcome back. So today I have a really fun and interesting watercolor project to share with you, and it's one that I've wanted to do for, oh gosh, at least half a year. And I think part of the reason that I put off creating this video was that I was afraid that it might look difficult, and I always want to be encouraging, and I always want you to see the video thumbnail and think, I can do that, I want to do that. Let me show you what we're going to do today. You might have already guessed if you've seen it on Instagram. We're going to create a dark, dramatic watercolor floral. And I know it looks like a bit much. It has this wonderful vintage vibe, and it's very dramatic, as I said already three times. But it's really not that difficult. Now, this is not a great first watercolor project if you're just getting started. We have a bazillion beginner projects on this channel. So, and I know a lot of you have been with me for years, and you're probably getting a little past beginner. So this is a great, like, very in between beginner and intermediate project. I'm gonna walk you through every step of it. I've got this great formula, I think, great formula for painting leaves that just goes in three steps, and it is so doable. And then the black is the final thing that you're going to paint. So you're just starting with flowers, and we've done a lot of flowers, and the black really isn't that difficult. So I really hope that you'll grab a paintbrush and give this a try with me today. And then before we jump right in, which we're gonna do in just a second, I wanna mention that I have a new watercolor e-course. I'm really excited about this e-course because I know a lot of you are genuinely trying to learn and grow with your watercolor practice. And to be honest, on YouTube, we try our best to make entertainment videos that are encouraging and that are teaching content, but we want it to be fun to watch. So I don't always get into the nitty-gritty of color theory, color mixing, the brushes I'm using, the paints, all of that stuff we've contained in this online workshop that I'm super excited to offer to you. It's available now on my website, shadacampbell.com, and it's over 25 videos. It's priced at $70 US, which I think is below most online courses. I want it to be accessible. And there's no time limit. If you purchase it, you can work through those videos at your own pace, because I believe in learning just slowly and having fun with watercolor and with all your art practice. So I hope you'll check it out. It's available on the website, as I said, and you can read the full course syllabus there to see if this online workshop might be right for you. So check it out after today's video. Okay, let's start on our dramatic, vintage-inspired watercolor floral. So our supplies today are really simple. I am going to be working on a 140-pound cold-pressed watercolor paper. This is a pad from Mikador. I'll link that in the description. You may want to stretch your paper for this. I'm not going to bother because I'm lazy, but it's not a bad idea since we are laying down a lot of paint. And then I have two animal hair brushes. These are really good quality. They're sable hair, and I have a number 2 and a number 4. Two glasses of clean water and some paper towel for blotting. Those brushes will be in the description as well. And then I will be using my watercolor set from Mengyo. I've mentioned this set a few times. I really love it. It's got a great color selection, excellent pigments. Link that in the description below as well. And then you'll want to have scrap paper and tracing paper to do your design on, and then to transfer the design, and then a pencil and maybe a pen. Okay, I'm going to start by working out the floral design, and I'll place two large circles where I want to place my flowers. Now, I want to keep the design really simple because it is black and white. I don't want a lot of small details. So we've got two large flowers.
When you're doing the flowers, think about where you're placing the stamen in the center. If the stamen's in the middle, you're going to have these four flat petals. If you place it a little lower, that front petal is much shorter and it gives the flower a look that it is a little more concave. It's going away from the viewer. So two or three big flowers plus lots of leaves is going to be, I think, your most successful design here. So keeping everything really big and everything really simple. I'm going over this in pen. Again, you can see this flower at the bottom. The stamen is right in the middle, so all the petals are equal length, and it's just sort of nice and big and flat and open. The upper one is a little more concave, so we're getting some depth there. And then just lots of leaves bordering or enclosing the flowers. You want to have a few leaves kind of tucked in behind the flowers so that everything looks really organic and there's a little bit of movement. And I'm also keeping my design off to one third of the page here. So it's offset, it's on the left side of the page, which I think looks nice. And then when you are happy with your design, we're going to trace it. And this allows you to make little changes. You can see I'm moving that middle stem over so that the front flower is actually in front of the stem. And again, that just helps everything to look really organic and natural, which is what we want for flowers. So let's get rid of our scrap paper. Now we've got our design really simple. It doesn't look perfect, but it will do. I'm going to flip that over and take a pencil and just add a layer of graphite to the back of our trace, flip it over again on top of the watercolor paper, and then use a nice sharp pencil to trace it one last time. You'll get to know your design really well, which is a good thing. And so we're going to go over everything carefully with a nice sharp pencil in order to transfer that onto the watercolor paper. Now you can use carbon transfer paper or graphite transfer paper, but you won't be able to erase them as well. Okay, and let's mix up some greens. I love this Mengyo set because it has a huge selection of greens and they're all really natural colors. This one here that I'm mixing kind of a darker green, but then there's this wonderful mossy green that I really love. And I think I've mentioned this in some other videos, but I've been very into mixing brown into my green lately. I've just realized how natural it looks when you have a bunch of green leaves, but some of them are a little more brown. I think it's a very nice combo, and you'll see me do that here. So let's start painting. The nice thing is when you have your transfer on the page, you know exactly where you're placing everything, so there's no guesswork, but you don't want to be too stiff about things either. So you're going to paint these leaves where you've placed them, but they don't need to fill the outline in exactly. So you can be a little bit free, especially since you're painting in black. You are not going to see those pencil lines. Think about making some of the leaves a little lighter and some a little darker. Mix a little more brown in for some of them and make some a little more green. As usual, we are doing the leaves or painting the leaves by dragging the belly of the brush across the page, and then you use the tip of your brush to refine the shape of the leaf. So you're using both the belly of the brush, the larger part, and that fine point on the end. And this is a great way to practice painting your leaves because you do have the layout done, so you know where you want to place each leaf. And basically, you're just going to fill them in with color. And as I said, think about making some a little lighter, some a little darker, and switch up the color slightly. Some could be almost brown, some could be a nice mossy green, and then some could be a darker green. So just filling in, and you can always play around with wet into wet. You can see me adding a bit of brown into that green area, and it just seeps out ever so beautifully. This leaf is pretty much a brown shade, a very greeny brown, but still a brown. And I think that just looks so nice. And you'll see when the piece is done, it looks so natural to actually have some brown leaves mixed in with the green ones. I'll also paint the leaves that are tucked in behind those flowers. Just be careful not to get any green where the blossom will be. And then when you're all done, we're going to join all those leaves together with the stems. And I'm just using sort of a darker green for this. You could use brown, it could be, either or, anything goes, and just carefully go over the stem. And you want to make sure that these branches are large enough that when you paint black around them, there's still something there. So you don't want to go too thin. Make them a little bit substantial, and you also don't want to go too dark. You don't want like a super dark brown or dark green because you want them to pop against the black. And if your branches aren't quite blending with the leaves, just add a little bit of extra water to help blend them together. Okay, and then when the leaves are done, we're going to come back with a bit of darker green. Mine have dried quite quickly, so I'm all ready to go. And we're just going to do a bit of shading on the leaves. So you've done a basic color, you've colored in all the leaves. Maybe they have a bit of brown and green, or maybe they're all quite flat. Either way, this is your chance to liven them up a little bit. And I am adding a bit of a darker green. Some of them I'll just add a little at the bottom. Some of the leaves, I'll put the shading just on one side. That can look nice. We just want to make it look like these leaves are not flat. They're curving, they're curling, they're crinkly, or they're in behind a flower. So they're a little bit in shadow in that way. So we're just thinking about adding a bit of shadow. But don't overdo it. And then we are going to come over to our palette and mix up a really dark green. So I am mixing an evergreen with a bit of brown. And then I'm also going to mix in gray. And that gives me this really rich green color. It might need a bit more green in there. But even if it's almost black, that's not necessarily a bad thing. This is the green we're going to use for our detail work. And you can see I have quite a bit of paint in my brush, but I'm just using the very tip of that round brush. And this is the number 2 that I'm using now. And I am doing these delicate lines. Some of them are a little broken. That's okay, that looks nice. And I'm going to add some veining to my leaves. And it's very perfectly imperfect. All of them are a little different, but you can see I basically just go down the center of each leaf. Now, where you place the center depends on how you see that leaf. Is the leaf on an angle? Is it straight on to the viewer? But basically, we're just putting a line somewhere near the middle, and then these little lines going off of it. So everything's very organic, very perfectly imperfect. And yeah, just be careful to use the very tip of that brush. And if a leaf is on an angle like this one, you might only see half of it, so half of the lines, and you'll place the center very far to one side. Now you can kind of see the method in my madness a little. We've done a very flat green leaf, added some shading, and then I think when the lines go on, it really pops. And if you need a little more shading at this point, you can of course add that. And then we are all done with the leaves. Time to move on to the flower. So we're mixing up a white, basically. I'm taking white paint and adding lots and lots of water to it. And then I will grab a little bit of brown. I like to put the brown on the palette and then just mix in just the tiniest bit. And then I also like to grab a little bit of gray. Same thing, I'll place it beside the white and then just add in a little bit so that I've created this really light taupe color. And that taupe will help me create a white flower on a white page. But first I want to get rid of any extra pencil marks. So then on a clean page, we're going to use that very light taupey gray, brown, beige color, and I am just adding a little bit to this flower. Now, because the flower is concave and the center is lower, I want to add shadow at the bottom here, near the bottom of each petal where it meets the stamen in the center. And when you're painting a white flower on a white page, you're really thinking about painting the shadow, painting the lowlights. So these petals in behind, they're a little darker. Everything down at the center of the flower is a little darker. But we are working, of course, with a very light, delicate color here. But you can see this coming together, and the key is to leave big areas of page showing through. You want to see that paper because the paper is the true color of the white flower. So you don't want a beige or taupe flower in the end. For this front petal, I'm shading the bottom of it because it is facing the other way. We're actually looking at the back of the petal. And so just a little shadow at the bottom. And then as I come around to do the second flower, I'm focusing on the same thing. The petals have a bit more shadow near the center of the flower. The petals in behind are a little bit darker because simply because the other petals are sitting on top of them, so they're gonna be a little more in shadow. And I am leaving big white areas because I do not want this to be a beige flower. I want it to be white. And this petal on the front of this flower is facing outwards, so it is just like the other four petals there, no difference. And just make sure that you're working with a very light shade of gray or beige, whatever color you've chosen to shade with. Keep it very light, keep it very watery, and leave lots of white page showing through. I think that is the key. And you don't have to get it in one try. Just start layering a little bit of that taupe color and then leave it alone, walk away, and we'll paint the center of the flower now. So I'm mixing up this dark, kind of like a honey colored brown. I have sort of a yellow ochre and then a bit of brown mixed in. And you can see on the palette, I've got everything from a really nice bright yellow to a brown, and I can grab from any area there so that I have sort of a mix of colors when I go to paint the stamen. And for this stamen in the center of the flower, I am just doing all these tiny little broken lines. They sort of form a bit of an open circle, but they're quite loose. And so this is a lot of fun to paint. This can be very perfectly imperfect. Just get in there, paint a lot of little lines that make up a bit of a circular shape in the center of the flower. And I think it looks really nice and it really brings the flower to life. All right, and then it is time to add the black. This can be a little scary. The first practice piece I did, I was like, I'm not adding black. but I think if you've done a large design, meaning the flowers and leaves are big and you don't have any small details, then adding the black really doesn't have to be that scary. And the nice thing is you just wanna add a really opaque black. You're not mixing much water into it, so you don't have to think about the shading. It is just dark black, so don't mix in too much water. You need it to be inky, like a very opaque ink. And just go carefully. A round brush is great for this because you'll be able to use the belly when you need to lay down a larger area of color. Just add a little more pressure, and then you can use just the fine point of that brush to get in and do all these little detailed areas. As you paint out towards the edge of the page, think about leaving a very rough border. So I've left a border of negative space. You can see the page showing through, and I'm adding a little extra water when I'm along the edges so that the black just gets ever so slightly transparent right on the edge. Or I'll also make it I'll sort of pull the brush along the page in such a way as to make that rough edge. So I think that's a nice way to kind of finish off the edges of the black. And this is a little bit time consuming, but you will get there. And just as you finish this up, be careful not to go over your painting with black. It's better to leave a little tiny border of white than it is to go over top of anything you've painted. And as you are finished with the black, you might decide your flowers need a little more shading, and so you can add that. Maybe they could just look, sometimes they look a little underwhelming once you've got that really dark black, and that just means they might need a little more shadow, but don't overdo it. You don't want to get too heavy-handed with the taupe or the gray. And there we go. The last thing that we are going to do is simply, if you've got a little bit of a white border around some of your stems and leaves where you just couldn't quite go too close with the black, now you can just come back in with a wash of green paint and just fill in. And if the green goes onto the black, you'll never see it. So that's a good trick. And then last thing, if you have any spots that aren't quite opaque, just go over them with black one more time, and that's it. That is our dark floral. This was so much fun to create. I feel like it looks like an old vintage botanical, and there's just something so dramatic about it. It is not difficult. I hope that through this tutorial, you'll see that this is something that you can totally do, and that will be quite impressive if you do. So thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to head over to Patreon to grab your art print if you're a patron, and I will see you soon with a new tutorial.